singing holy, holy to my one and only, who is like our God. Let our hearts adore you as we bow before you. There is no one like our God. Singing holy, holy to my one and only, who is like our God. Let our hearts adore you as we bow before you. There's no one like our God. Singing holy, holy to my one and only, who is like our God. Let our hearts adore you as we bow before you. There's no one like our God. No, I can never grow tired of telling you you're worthy. There is no one like our God. No, I can never get tired. I'm telling you, you're worthy. There is no one like our God. No, I can never grow tired of telling you you're worthy. There's so many ways I can sing of your glory. No, I can never get tired of telling you you're worthy. There's so many ways I can sing of your glory. No, I can never get tired of telling you you're worthy. There's so many ways I can sing of your glory. No, I can never get tired of telling you you're worthy. Over and over again. Over and over again. Over and over again. Over and over again.
Praise God. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Once again, saints, we just thank God for you. We love you. Thank God for the word of God. You can open your Bibles, if you would, to the book of Ephesians chapter 6. I want to talk about how you dress today. Amen. Amen. Are you dressed appropriate or not? Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. You know, if anyone needs a Bible, lift your hands. The ushers, we all know we use a lot of scripture. Amen. 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 And we just want to be land upon land and precept on precept. But I want to call today, are you dressed for the battle? Amen. Yours. Amen. Hallelujah. How you dressed today? Amen. Glory to God. Ephesians chapter 6, we will read verses 10 through 18. Amen. Very familiar passage, I know, to all of us. Amen. We've taught on it. You've read on it, probably studied it. But it concerns our clothing. Our armor, our battle gear. Amen? Amen? I want to ask you to read along together with me, beginning at verse 10. I'll read verse 10, and then y'all read 11, and we'll alternate as we go. That way we're all involved. Amen? Amen? Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Let's read 18 together. praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Amen. Amen. Father, we ask you to bless the reading of the word. Amen. Open our hearts, our minds to receive, and we thank you for it in advance. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 The Apostle Paul here is talking about being dressed. Amen. You know, we've been teaching a series called Dress for the Battle. Amen. Amen. And we kind of build up to this point where we are right now. And so we're going back, picking back up. We took a break on last week, but we're back and we're going to pick up. And I'm going to call today, are you dressed for the battle? Amen. Now, the battle I'm talking about is yours. Amen. Your individual walk, your individual struggle, the battle that you engage in day by day as we serve the Lord Jesus. Amen. But I'm going to ask you a question in starting today. I don't know about you, but have you ever dressed up the wrong way for an occasion?
Yeah. Yeah. Amen.
Amen. You went dressed up and you got there and it was casual.
Yeah.
Amen. Now, that's embarrassing, yes, but that doesn't hurt you.
Right.
Amen. Now, if you dress the wrong way for a job interview, that can hurt you.
Amen.
Amen. How we dress, I want us to think about that, is really important. What we put on when we go out is vital. Amen. I've been in situations where I've gone out dressed casual and got there, people were dressed up. It's always an awkward situation, but really, we don't lose anything beyond our natural embarrassment. You know, I remember one time, you know, we used to kind of dress to go to school when we were growing up. You know, going to school, we used to dress a certain way, didn't we? You wanted to look good when you went to school. And that's kind of a generational thing. But I remember one time the bus was coming, and we used to sing like a little chant when the bus was coming. We used to sing the B-U-S, the S-U-B. I don't know if Esau remember that or not, but I remember we used to sing that from time to time. Well, the bus was coming, and I got in a rush. I had my clothes on, but I didn't have my shoes on. And so when I was getting ready to run out, I just grabbed shoes. And when I got on the bus, I looked down. I had on mismatched shoes. Pastor wasn't dressed right. But thank God for good friends. When I got to school, you know, I had a friend. He asked me, why was my feet stuck up under the desk like that? I said, man, I got the wrong mismatched shoes on. You know, Alfonso, that was his name. He offered to swap shoes with me, and then we both had mismatched shoes. And what was extremely embarrassing became something that we felt good about all of a sudden.
Amen.
See, that's how a friend is, isn't it?
Amen.
Well, it's important that we dress right.
Amen.
Amen. The apostle here is talking about being clothed with the armor of God. And but before, I want you to think a little bit more about this issue of how we dress. Amen, because, you know, dressing the wrong way for an event, whether it was myself in school or showing up in an event not dressed appropriate. I remember one time I went to one thing and I got there and it was casual. I had on dress shoes and they wanted to play basketball. What we would do is play ball in our dress shoes. But we managed to get it done. On a more serious vein, however, how you dress can affect your life in a major way. Proper attire is really important. And, you know, if you think about hunting, it's a little more serious. You might notice when you see people deer hunting, they generally wear clothes that are designed to stand out. You don't want to wear a brown coat and you're going in the woods to hunt, because then you kind of look like a deer in the brush. So they wear clothing to make themselves less of a target for an accidental shooting.
Amen.
And that's why oftentimes you'll see like a blaze orange or a bright neon green, so you'll stand out from the background. Because if you dress wrong in that situation and you're mistaken to be something you are not, then it's a little more serious and it could be life-threatening or it could be fatal.
Amen.
How you dress for the occasion is extremely serious. It's even more serious when you think about an officer of the law, a policeman. You know, They dress, but you know, notice we normally see them, and they have on a big old belt, and and on that belt, their attachments there, isn't it? Might be a billy club, a Glock, a taser, might be pepper spray, I don't know. But if they go out the door just dressed in a uniform, it could be a deadly situation. If you go out the door and don't have the protective vest on, you subject yourself to potential injury or loss of life. Same thing if it's a soldier going somewhere with this. You might dress, but if you don't put on all of your required covering, you make yourself subject to being endangered. And so a soldier goes out to battle with a helmet, a vest, specially designed shoes and boots. In other words, designed to protect themselves. And if you go out and not dress for the occasion, going to battle without your battle gear on, then you've exposed yourself to potential loss of life. Extremely serious, isn't it? If it's that way in the natural, you know, we've seen police officers in a riot situation with a shield. You know, if you don't have the right equipment for a situation you find yourself in, you know, you subject yourself to injury or death, don't you? What we are talking about is a natural portrayal of a spiritual situation. It's just as important for you and I as believers to be dressed right. See, when I talk about how you dress, I'm talking about how you dress this morning. See, we're not talking about modest or immodest. We're talking about how you dressed to go out into this world and to face the foes that you have. Amen. Amen? And that's why we call this, are you dressed for your battle? Amen? And the Apostle Paul here is talking about it, but before we even get to the whole armor of God, before you put on your suit, before you put on your vest, before you put on your helmet, before you go out the door equipped to go out and chase devils or whatever you do, you better make sure you got your underclothing right, your undergarments. And so before the apostle gets to verse 13, it says, take the armor of God. Verse 10, he sort of lays the foundation for what you do before you get dressed. And so I call this your under armor, amen. Or some would say underwear, amen. See, he says, now before you put on the armor, first you need to realize some things, brother, sister. You need to realize, finally, my brethren, in closing this book out, he says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord. Before you go out to spiritual battle, you need to realize that the power you operate in is not yours. See, we've been authorized by God, but the power is his. And he's encouraging us, first and foremost, this is what we clothe ourselves with before we put on the shield of faith, before we take on the girdle of truth. We need to realize that our strength comes from God. Amen. And so he says, finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord. Realize where your strength comes from. Amen. Amen. Be strong in the Lord. That's a command. Amen. Amen. So he's talking to an army. You're a soldier, aren't you? Amen. Whether you chose to be or not, amen. You know, this world is a battlefield. And it's obvious that this world is engaged in something that's bigger than what we see based on what we see happening around us on a daily basis. It's not normal the state we see this world in right now. People are doing a lot of abnormal, wicked, and on the surface, it seems like there's no rhyme or reason to it. Why would you even think just go out and just on the cuff, amen, at a thought, begin to spray and to shoot into a crowd of people? You know, that's not normal thinking. It's spiritual. And so we need to be dressed not to deal with physical foes, but spiritual, the ones we don't see. In order to do that, we've got to realize that we fight on a battlefield in a war where we don't see the enemy. We see the evidence of the enemy. We see it being manifest all around us, but I can't see behind the scenes to see who is pulling the strings and manipulating folk to do the things that people do. And so I need to understand then, I've got to address this thing not in my strength, but in his. So he's writing to the brethren to be strong, empowered in the Lord and in the power of his might. Amen. You got to do this thing. You got to realize that your might comes from God, and it's a command to be strong. And the way that's really laid out in the original writing, it means to be continually strong. Don't rely on you. You have to rely on him. Be strong in the Lord. And one of the challenges we have is to feel like, man, I can do pretty good on my own. Yeah, in the flesh you might, but you're not fighting against flesh. Amen. And so what I normally trust with my intellect and my own ability is not sufficient, because I'll be honest, you're not going to outthink the devil in your flesh. Amen. He's been at this thing a whole lot longer than you and I have. He studied and knows human nature, and so we can't fight on the ground. He wants you to stay in the flesh. And if you're in the flesh, you're weak, but if you're in the spirit, you're strong. And so we're told to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might or his ability. Amen. So we got to know then that, you know, Jesus said the same thing in John 15, 5. He says that without me, you can do nothing. However, Philippians 4, 13 says that with him, we can do all things. So our strength doesn't come from us, not in the spiritual sense. Amen. You can't rely on your brain and your intellect when it talks about dressing up for spiritual battle. Amen. Amen. You've got to realize on what God has given you and I in his word and the resources we have through the Spirit of God. And so we're commanded to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. You know, Psalms 121:1 says, I will lift up mine eyes to the hills from whence cometh my help. So we have to realize, and I can't rely on my natural ability. See, this is before I put on the armor. I have to have the mindset in place. This is not of me, amen. I don't have the strength or the ability in my flesh to cope with what's coming against us daily in this world. And that's why a lot of people are losing hope right now. They're trying to fight spiritual battles with natural weapons. You know, counseling can't win this battle for you. Sometimes we got to address the spirit behind it. Amen. Sometimes we got to learn. Now, I'm not saying counseling ain't good. Don't get me wrong. Amen. It's good, because some things we have to deal with in the realm of our thinking. Amen. And that's, you know, so that's good. But then there are other times where we're dealing with things that we don't see that are agitating and stirring behind the scenes. And it's not of the mind or the psyche. Amen. It's not psychological, as it were. Amen. It's not physical. It's spiritual. And what we see happening in the world around us today is spiritual. Amen. You know, people are wondering, why is this happening? What can we do about it? What's the government going to do? Actually, the government's behind a lot of it. Amen. So you got to realize the government wants to cause a crisis so they can get more power, because you have a lot of wicked folk that want to control you. That's right. Amen. See, that's spiritual. Amen. Amen. You know, once people get wealthy and got money, the next thing is to gain power. So we have to understand how this world works around us, so that we won't be overwhelmed, so we won't be discouraged, so that we won't quit when the pressure comes on you, because we're going to see here in the Word of God that there is an evil day that comes your way. And if you're not equipped to stand when that day comes, you will fall. See, that's dangerous. And so God wants you and I equipped for these days. But first, before you strap on anything else, before you get your sword, you got to get the right underclothing straight first. Be strong in him. Amen. Amen. Don't rely on yourself. Amen. Jeremiah 17, 5 says, cursed be the man that makes the arm of flesh his strength. Amen. Amen. See, sometimes we rely on this flesh of ours. But I'm telling you, flesh will fail you. Amen. Amen. You might say, I got this, but in the middle of that, amen, you find out, I really don't. Amen. See, we can't trust our flesh. Amen. Your flesh didn't get saved. You got born again of the spirit. Your flesh can still be tempted. Your mind can still get messed up, amen, even as a Christian. And the enemy sends fiery darts against us to get us off in our thinking, amen, to distort how we see reality and how we live. And so we have to address these things spiritually. But we don't come in our ability. We come in his, amen? Hallelujah, amen. We got to know where our help is, amen. And that's why Paul is saying this. And then after he says, you know, get your clothing straight, get your undergarments right. Then he tells us in verse 10, we're going to go through this verse by verse, is a command to you and I. Amen. After you settle the issue on who you rely on. Amen. Because all of these things work by faith. They work based on our relying on his ability at work in us. See, the Bible says greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. But if you don't know how to work that, the one that's in the world will still overwhelm you and I. And newsflash, he don't wait for you to become a mature Christian. He starts on you. Amen. Actually, he started on you from the moment you were conceived to lay a plan to keep you from coming to Jesus, to cause you to procrastinate, to be set where you receive false teaching, to be set where you trusted other things other than Jesus for your salvation. That's why you're called an overcomer when you got saved. Amen. You overcame a system that was set to keep you from Jesus, and therefore, once you got saved, who is he that overcomes the world but he that believeth that Jesus Christ is Lord, amen? Amen, is the Son of God. So you're not trying to be an overcomer. You're already an overcomer. See, how we receive that determines how we respond. So I'm not trying to overcome. I overcame when I got saved. Now I've got to learn to live it as an overcomer from that point. And I cannot do it in my ability. I need his strength. That old song said, I need thee. Oh, I need thee. Every hour. Amen. I need thee. Amen. That's true, isn't it? So we need him day by day, moment by moment. We need his strength. We need his wisdom. We need his resources. And so clothe yourself first with that. Amen. That in me that is in my flesh, as Paul said, dwells no good thing. Amen. That I can't rely on my own ability because I don't see who I'm standing against. Amen. And then he begins to address this issue of our spiritual clothing. Notice it says then, verse 11, put on the whole armor of God. Amen. God's not going to put this on you. Same way an officer gets dressed, you got to get dressed. If you're not dressed right, things don't go very well. So we're talking about being dressed for the battle. Who puts the armor on? You do. Amen. Well, if it's for me, it's mine. Nope, if you don't put it on, you don't get it. So we have to learn how to clothe ourselves in his armor. Amen? Amen. To be strong in him. Like I said, operating in no confidence in the flesh. If you're looking for a scripture there, Philippians 3, verse 13. Don't have confidence in you. Amen. But in him. Why? When you're weak, that's when you're strong. I keep getting drawn back to that. Amen. See, our normal tendency is to rely on ourselves. Our intellect, I can figure my way out through this. Well, if you can't see where it's coming from, you can't handle it in a natural way. That's where we have to trust him. Amen? Amen. Not our flesh. Amen? So we have to look at your neighbor and say, put it on. Put on the armor. Amen. You know, right here in Philippians 6 is not the only time where this armor is alluded to in the Bible. It's alluded to in the Old Testament. So it's not a new thing the apostle is talking about. This is something that goes back even in scripture, the armor of God, amen. You know, if you would, Isaiah 59, verse 16 and 17. If you turn with me there, you'll see it, amen. This is God's armor, amen. And he called it the whole armor of God, didn't he? Amen. Verse 16, he says, and he saw that there was no man and wondered that there was no intercessor. Therefore, his arm brought salvation unto him, and his righteousness, it sustained him. For he put on righteousness as a breastplate. We're going to see Paul talking about a breastplate of righteousness, New Testament. But here we see the Lord Jesus, and the commentators say that it's like Jesus is portrayed here as a hero. Amen. Out to rescue his people. Amen. Now, I know like in movies and comic books, you know, superhero movies, they're out to save the planet. Well, Jesus came to save the world from their sin. Actually, those ideas of superheroes and deliverers actually were taken from the Word of God. And it says he put on righteousness as a breastplate and a helmet of what? Salvation upon his head. And he put on the garments of vengeance for clothing and was clad with zeal as a cloak. That's Jesus. Jesus is my hero. Amen. He came to deliver not just me, but all of us and the world from the penalty of sin. God so loved the world that he gave him, but he came clothed, dressed for battle. And he contended with principalities and powers and Satan, even Satan himself, and defeated him so you and I could partake of the free gift of salvation. I don't know about you, but that makes him my hero. Amen. Jesus is a conquering king. Amen. And he put it on to save you and I. Amen. Hallelujah. He was dressed to save. Amen. Now, he didn't come as an earthly soldier. He didn't come to set up an earthly kingdom at that point. But he came and he had weapons. He said he had righteousness as a breastplate and a helmet of salvation. And he came to do warfare on your behalf and man. And the Bible says he took from Satan the armor that he trusted in. Amen. Then in Revelation 1:18, Jesus said, I am he that liveth and was dead, but behold, I'm alive forevermore, and I have the keys of hell and death. He conquered death, hell, and the grave so that you and I wouldn't have to go to hell. Amen. So that you and I could have eternal life in Christ Jesus. He's my hero. I don't know about you, but man, he's my conquering king. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. Jesus is a mighty warrior. Amen. And he clothed himself that way to deliver us. Amen. He was a moral king, a righteous king. Amen. A delivering king. And now you and I are being bequeathed or given his armor. I'm going to let that sink in for a second. You see here, that was the Lord's armor, wasn't it? But then we come back to Ephesians 6. He tells us to put on not ours, but the whole armor of God. Put it on. The whole armor of God. Praise God. Amen. And it's not earthly weapons. They're spiritual weapons. Amen. I don't have to see them to know that I'm covered with it. I believe it and receive it by faith. Amen. We're going to see as we go through that each element of this armor he discusses is an aspect of the Word of God. The operation of the Word of God through you and I as we intentionally put on the clothing God has intentionally put on the clothing God gave us. You have to put it on. See, a lot of us are passive in our walk. Amen. You know, we still have a lot of people. And if it's you, don't look around, amen. Nobody know I'm talking about you. But if you still have what I call an Old Testament mentality where you're holding your peace and waiting for the Lord to fight your battle. But Pastor, the song said, the song was wrong. That was Old Covenant, Old Testament. And it wasn't just every battle that the nation Israel got in. He said, in this battle, amen. Send Judah first. Hold your peace and let the Lord fight. Other battles, we saw them go out and fight. See, sometimes the danger for us often is taking a scripture out of its setting and misapplying it. And then expecting God to do the fighting for us when he told us to do it ourselves. Amen. I believe it's James 4:7 where he said, first submit to God. See, that's how you clothe yourself. And resist the devil. And he will flee. Well, if you don't resist him, he don't flee. And so he's put it on you and I to be the resistor. Well, I'm holding my peace. Wait, no, that don't work there. If you don't resist, the devil don't go. If you don't fight back, Amen. Remember a few weeks ago I said, believers, we got to get our fight back. You know, we get too passive. We just roll over, let the devil roll over us, steamroll us. Now stand up. And that's what Paul is saying. Stand and stand therefore. Stop backing down from Satan. Amen. You know, this nation is in the shape that it's in right now because we backed up. We stopped being salt which preserves. We stopped being salt that irritates. We stopped being light so that people can see. In other words, we just rolled over. The Bible says righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to every people. Well, in the face of all the sin around us, the church is pretty much backed up. We're not standing, amen. We're not clothed for our battle, amen. Holding our peace, letting the Lord fight our battles. Victory shall be mine. No, you won't get victory that way. Amen. See, the Old Testament, even in the Old Testament, amen, yeah, God fed them with manna and quail when they were in the wilderness, but as soon as they crossed over the Jordan, the Bible says the manna ceased. They had to go out and do for themselves in the strength of God, amen, because that represented where you and I are now in the promised land. We have to fight. We have to resist. We have to stand. It's not if it's for me, it's for me. How many of y'all been, I hope y'all ain't been quoting that, but you hear it all the time, don't it? Now, it can be for you, but if you don't go get it, you're never going to have it. See, you got to reach out by faith. The Bible says the kingdom suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. Amen. A lot of things are for us, but if we don't reach out and grab it, we don't receive it. Salvation is for every man, and it's God's will that all be saved. But if you don't place faith in Jesus and receive the free gift, you'll die and bust hell wide open. Amen. So you've got to reach out and receive what God has for you. And then you have to fight to keep what God has given you. Amen? Amen. We got to fight for the family. Amen. We got to fight for what we know is right. Just because they said, oh, this is a man and this ain't and this is a woman and then no. We got to fight to stay in truth. Amen. See, that's called a girdle of truth that we'll see a little later. Amen. You got to surround yourself with the truth of what God said. And you got to fight to stay in truth. Amen. 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 If you learn anything, say amen. 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 Praise God. And so we're not going to cover all this today. You already know that. Amen. But you have to put on the armor of God. Amen. And so we have to take the initiative then. You resist. You cast out. Amen. You cast down. Even when it comes to your thought life. You know, thoughts come, but you don't have to entertain them. But if you will just let your man run wild, it'll run wild. The darts will come. They'll undermine you. Satan attacks your validation. You know, he wants people to validate you. You know, your insufficiency, thoughts come, amen. Well, 2 Corinthians 10 tells us to cast down those imaginations that come, every thought that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. If you don't do it, it don't get done. See, as a Christian, the Lord is not going to do for us what he told us to do. And so if it's going to be done, we have to do it, not in our strength, but through what he's given us, his power. Amen. The devil isn't afraid of you. He's afraid of Christ in you. Amen. And see, that's our hope of glory. Amen. The greater one indwells you and I. Amen. And so we have to put on the armor of God. Why? So we can stand. Yes. Amen. And that's why he tells us now, if you can put on the whole armor, yes, that means you can be partially clothed. That's right. So you're going out the door. Mm-hmm. Amen. Going into the world that's set against you. Amen. But you forgot the girdle of truth. Yes. And the girdle holds everything in place. Right. Amen, ladies. Amen. Amen. Girdle keeps everything. You know, men wear girdles too. Amen. You know, actually, that big, wide belt that you see officers wear, technically that's a girdle. That's where you place your weapons on. Amen. If it was a soldier, amen, in ancient times, say Rome, that's where the sword would be. They could actually hang the little round shield on that girdle as well. Amen. The Israelis, when they went to war, they might have worn long robes, but then they would pull them up about this high and tuck it into that girdle so it would impede them as they fought. Amen. See, truth is what holds everything together. Amen. And so that's part of our clothing. Don't want to get too far ahead. But we have to do it. We have to put it on. Amen. And so if there's anything that you and I remember today, we have to do what God commissioned or told us to do. Amen. He's not going to do for us what he told us to do through him. Amen. 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 And the reason he tells us this is so we'll be fully dressed. Amen. Hallelujah. Not half dressed. And the thought that comes to my mind then is that is one of intentionality. We have to choose to be clothed on purpose. See, a lot of things don't happen accidentally. Amen? You have to realize that if we're to be rightly dressed spiritually, we have to be intentional about our walk in Christ. See, there are seven weapons that are going that he goes through here. Well, Pastor, there are only six parts of the armor. Yeah, but the part that empowers the armor is your prayer, number seven. See, if you don't pray, you don't get your weapons on the field. So we have to learn how to work this thing. No matter how young I am or no matter how old I am. Amen. The word will still work for me. But I've got to take all the armor of God. Amen. Well, Pastor, I got some of it. Well, all believers, amen, when you got saved, yeah, you have a helmet of salvation. You're saved. If you're saved, say amen.
Amen.
Yeah, but what are you saved from? See, it's one thing to be saved. Amen. But if you don't have a revelation of new creation reality, Satan will still keep you in bondage. He'll keep you bound by your past. He'll keep you bound by how other people saw you before you got saved. Amen. Because they remember you as you were. It takes time and a consistent walk for them to see a real change in you. Amen. Matter of fact, if you don't you have the helmet on, yes, that's default when you got saved. But how do you use it? See, that's the thing. How do I put this on? The Bible tells us to put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh. But how do I do this, Pastor? How do I put on this helmet of salvation? The word there means you're saved. Amen. You've been rescued. But how does this operate in my life? Thanks for asking. Amen. If you don't have a working knowledge of who you are now in Christ. See, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, Paul said, henceforth, verse 16, we know no man after the flesh. And if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Now, the way I'm going to operate this, I got to realize and understand and walk in the revelation of the fact I am a new creation. I'm saved, but if you understand that as a Christian now, you are a new creation, that you don't have a past. Your life didn't begin until you got saved. Wait a minute, but I was living. Yeah, you were the walking dead. The Bible says you were dead in trespasses and sin before you got saved. You were born in a state of being separated from God. And all that separated you from a devil's hell was the breath in your body. But then you heard the gospel of Christ and you called on Jesus to save you. And you were born again of the Spirit. Well, but Pastor, I did all these nasty, mean, wicked, perverse things in my past. Yeah, but they were all washed away in the blood of Jesus. Amen. And the man or woman or boy or girl that you were coming to Jesus, you go from Jesus a new person. You have no past. See, if you realize that as a new creation in Christ Jesus, the next part of that verse says, old things, what happened to them? So they're dead then, aren't they? Wait a minute. You know, my land, my stealing, my fornication, my adultery, you know, it could even be murder. All the stuff that you did before you got saved, when you got saved, all those things were washed away, put in a sea of forgetfulness, and God is no more charging that sin to your account. Why? Because you received Christ, who bore that sin at the cross, and you received from the cross a new life. Amen. You've been born again. And so when the thoughts begin to come and people begin, I remember I used to say, yeah, but that person isn't here anymore. Amen. I'm a new creation in Christ. I've been born again of the Spirit of God. That's why I say I'm 40-some years old. Amen. Physically, I'm 65. Amen. But spiritually, amen, I'm a new creation there in Christ Jesus. Old things. In the past, I did this and that and the other. Yeah, but that's not charged to my account. How many forgiven sinners we got in here? Newsflash, let's straighten that up right now. Amen. You're not a forgiven sinner. You were forgiven while you were a sinner. See, the Bible says even when we were in our sins, Christ died for us. All the world is comprised of forgiven sinners. But when you got saved, you are no longer a forgiven sinner. You are now the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Isn't that what the Bible calls you? Romans 5:17 says, they that receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one Christ Jesus. Amen. See, old things have passed away and now all things are new. Question, can you be a new creation and still be the sinner that you were? No. You know, that scripture in the Bible that calls you a forgiven sinner. Amen. That's tradition. It sounds good, but it's not biblically sound. See, we have to get clothed with that understanding so the enemy can't keep us stuck in our past pattern, our past life. I am not a forgiven sinner. I now stand as a new creation in Christ Jesus. I don't have a past from that point. Amen. I've got a present and a future in Christ. Amen. Yeah, but Pastor, sinner sin. Well, the difference between you being a new creation and a forgiven sinner is that sinners practice sin. Now, how many of you get up every morning trying to find out what evil you can get in, who you can sleep with, and what you can do? Nah, that was in your old life, amen. Now, you stumble as a Christian, and we have 1 John 1:9 for that. Amen. And so we not perfect because we're born of the Spirit, but this flesh. We got to bring in on a subjection, don't we? We got to discipline the flesh and beat it in line because it's not redeemed until it doesn't receive the fullness of redemption until Jesus comes. When we get our new body, then this body has to be controlled through our spirit. See, when the Bible says, walk in the Spirit and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. See, that's new creation talk there. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, if I were to say how many sinners saved by grace do we have in the house? You know, hands will go up. I'm not going to call for a hand check this time. That's not biblical either. Because if you're born again, God doesn't consider you a sinner. You're now a saint and of the household of God. You are now a new creation. See, those are sayings that people say, but are they biblically sound? No. I'm going to let that float out there for a second there. You see, because these things, these traditions get in us. And as long as we hold ourselves in the realm of I am a sinner practicing sin mentality, and I'm a sinner saved by grace, I was a sinner, but grace saved me. See, that's different talk, amen. See, we got to get our language right. No, I'm not perfect. Yes, I miss it from time to time. He understood that, amen. But it doesn't come. See, now this helps us to understand the Bible. One scripture says that if you're in him, you cannot sin in John. How many of y'all read that before? And people say, see, that's a contradiction because there it says you cannot sin because his seed is in you. Not when you understand you're a new creation in Christ. If you're a forgiven sinner, yeah, you got an issue there. But if you know that you have been made a new creation, no, sin doesn't come from my newborn spirit. No. Amen. That seed does not sin, but if Satan gets hold of my mind and my thoughts and makes appeals to me and I begin to think wrong and judge wrong, my body is going to follow me into sin and my spirit is, I'm being convicted. Because I know it's not right. Amen. So the sin that we stumble into is a result of our flesh and our thinking. Doesn't mean that you hadn't been born again of the Spirit of God. See, that's how we clothe ourselves. I'm a new creation. Amen? In Christ Jesus. Amen. And Paul went on to say, not only are all things become new, all things are of God. Amen. We got to read this. Amen. Boy, the word is good, isn't it?
Amen.
See, we're talking about getting dressed right.
Amen.
Amen. Putting our clothes on. Amen. All things have become new. Verse 18, all things are of God who had reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ and given to us the ministry of reconciliation. Note the next verse, to know or to witness that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and had committed unto us the word of reconciliation. That's what we're to go let them know. Jesus paid the price. He's not holding the sin over you. He bore it on the cross. Now, if you die in your sins, then you pay. If you receive the free gift of salvation, you receive what he's done. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. For God had made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. See, it's all in him, isn't it?
Amen.
Amen. I'm made the righteousness of God in him. Amen. You know, the Bible says that he's redeemed our life from destruction in Psalms 103. Amen. 1 Thessalonians 1:10 says he's delivered you and I from the wrath to come. Salvation is deliverance.
Amen.
Amen. And so once we get our minds wrapped around that fact, wait a minute, I can begin to resist these things because I understand that it's not in my nature. Because now I'm saved.
Amen.
So I have to learn to renew my mind, Romans 12, 1 and 2. And 1 Corinthians 9, 24 to 27 says, I've got to beat this body and bring it into subjection. I've got to discipline. I need to fast it. Amen. At times, I need to know, body, you're not doing that today. Amen. I took that first look, but the second one. See, you gotta work your flesh. You got to deal with it. Bring it into subjection. Amen. Matter of fact, Paul was so bold as to say, I'm crucified with Christ. Died with him, yet nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ in me. Amen. He said concerning baptism, Romans 6:4. That we were buried with him in baptism. So that as like as Christ was raised from the dead, so too have we been raised to walk in the newness of life, new life. Not old life covered, new life. I am saved. Let's say this. I am saved. I am born again. I'm born of the Spirit of God. Old things have passed away. And behold, look, all things are become new. I'm not bound by my past. My past is under the blood. And you can't hold me in my past either. In Jesus' name. Amen. See, sometimes we get held up in our past, don't we? Amen. Another part that we hadn't really got on to putting it on, we won't today. Time and friendly. But you do have a breastplate of righteousness, don't you?
Amen.
Amen. Well, you got it on, amen. You're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. You are born again, John 3:3. Now, question. Can you be born again and still be who you were? See, that deals away. I just lay in scripture on that, you know, to kind of take the traditional things and I call them sacred cows. And they moo and then they fall over. I'm a new creation. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, this week, you need to remind yourself, I'm a new man. I'm a new girl. I'm a new boy. I've been born of the Spirit of God. Amen. My body won't tell me what to do. It won't make me do. Amen. People can't keep me bound to my past. Why? I am born again. Amen. I'm saved. Amen. Now I have a breastplate of righteousness on as well. Amen. But if I don't understand what righteousness is. See, it's one thing to say, I put on the breastplate of righteousness. But what is righteousness? It's simply right standing with God. Amen. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says that you are now made the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. As a result of being born of the Spirit of God, you're now made right with God, not through your actions, but because you were washed in the blood of Jesus. In other words, I changed kingdoms when I got saved. I was translated out of the kingdom of darkness and placed in the kingdom of God's dear Son. Amen. And now I have a new father, a heavenly father. Amen. Whereby I cry, Abba, Father. Amen. It's a relational thing. I've got right standing with God, and that's my breastplate of righteousness. Now, having right standing with God means I'm privy to certain privileges as a believer. Amen? In other words, that if he's my father, the same way that you as a parent, amen, want to see your kids do well and give them good things, that's how God is about you. Yeah, but a lot of Christians don't believe God wants to do good stuff for them. So, and if you fall in that category where you wrestle with that, you're not really putting on the breastplate of righteousness. Amen? Amen? Amen. In other words, you're not getting the benefit of this new birth experience because you still don't feel like you have a right to the throne of grace to receive help in the time of need. How do people express that? Man, you know, I don't know if God got time for me. You know, you come, you heard people pray this way before. I know God is busy. No, he's not too busy for you. You ever felt like that? I don't want to bother him. He knew about your problem before you were conceived.
Amen.
Made provision. And said, therefore, let us come boldly. See, if we don't have understanding that I have a right to come to him now because I'm a son, I'm a daughter, and he has an open door policy. When I call, he answers. Amen. Doesn't the Bible say that the eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous and his ears are attentive to their prayer? Amen. And so that if you have right standing with God, he's listening for your cry. Amen. So I don't have to back up. I can come boldly the same as I would. You know, you don't back up to the table to eat when you're home. Daddy, mom, you know, can I eat today? Amen. No, you have an expectancy, a right to our table, don't you? And so you don't back in and go, mom or daddy, please. No, you prop yourself up and you're ready to eat. Why? Because you know you're received there. When you understand you have that type of standing with Christ, amen. God accepts you because you accepted Jesus, amen. You can come boldly to the throne of grace. Not as humble as I know how. Just come boldly. Just come. You don't have to fix it up and dress it up, amen. Just come as you are to him. Amen. Don't make pretend. You know, he's your father. Go to Matthew chapter 7, verse 7, and then we'll get ready to close. Amen. And we'll just pick this up. Matthew chapter 7. Amen. For time, verse 11. 7:11. 7:11. If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your Father in heaven give good things to them that ask him.
Amen.
See, that's what righteous I ask because I know he wants to minister to and meet that need. So now I can come in faith, knowing that he'll give good things to those that ask him. You know, if you ask for a fish, verse 10 said, will you give him a serpent? No. Verse 9, If you ask for bread, will you give him a stone? No. Our Father wants us to ask, and he'll give us good things. And so he says, you have not because you ask not. Wow. So when I get a revelation on the fact that I have a breastplate of righteousness, of sonship, of right standing, father-son, father-daughter relationship with God the Father, I can come in the name of Jesus, whatsoever you ask the Father in my name, he give it you. See, that'll change the way we pray, didn't want it. We can then have an expectancy about us because God delights to do good for his children. Just like an earthly parent delights to do good for their children. Amen. And so it changes my whole perspective. And so I put on a righteousness as a breastplate. It's not something I earn. It's not works righteousness. It's a gift from God. Romans 5:17. And when you receive the gift of a right standing, the Bible says there, you will reign in life through Christ Jesus. So our ability to walk in as an overcomer in this life is based on our understanding our rights and privileges in Christ Jesus. Because I'm a son, he's given me an anointing. Because I'm a son or a daughter of God, I have a right to use the name of Jesus. Amen. And when I use the name of Jesus, I have God's attention. Amen. And the devils tremble. Uh-oh, that one knows how to use the name. And they use it with authority. And so when we say we bind you in the name of Jesus, devil's bound. And we say we drive you out, cast you out, they got to go. Amen. See, why? Because he honors us as we stand in faith in our rights and privileges in Christ Jesus. Amen. We have to know who we are in Christ. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. That's why when we resist, he begins to flee. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. We'll go ahead and wrap up for the time of sake. Sake of time. I said for the time of sake then. Wow. Amen. Amen. Let's close up. Amen. And so he says, put on that armor. Amen. That you may be able to stand. If you don't put on the whole armor, you won't be able to stand against the wiles, the devices, the strategies, the schemes of the devil. Amen? Amen. The way he operates. So we need this armor on, don't we?
Amen.
Amen. Why? This is where we close, amen. Our present predicament. Yes. Notice the next verse. See, I said everything around us that we see happening physically is an indicator of the spiritual contention behind the scenes that you and I do not see. Amen? Our nation right now is in moral free fall, isn't it? But what the nation doesn't understand is that it is a victim of spiritual warfare. Amen. When we see violence spilling over into the streets, when we see all these things happening, amen, people that do those deeds don't understand by what spirit they operate in. In other words, when we see immorality being paraded, amen, they don't understand that at its root it is spiritual.
Amen.
Amen. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. We see these things manifested in the flesh. Every crisis around us right now.
Amen.
When they talk about morality, it's spiritual.
Amen.
If your morals are good, your behavior will be good.
Amen.
Amen. If you're immoral, you do immoral acts. Amen. And so we have to get the heart right to get the action straight.
Amen.
That's a spiritual new birth that people need, isn't it?
Amen.
Amen. It's all based, amen, on spiritual warfare. Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And so we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Four classes of fallen angels or demons we wrestle against, and we don't see any of them. We see the results of them being there in the actions of people. As we say, a murdering spirit can't kill anybody unless somebody yields their body to that spirit.
Amen.
And so the enemy wants to invade the mind, to infect the thinking, to drive the action of an individual. That's spiritual. We don't wrestle against flesh. The spirits, they seek to hinder your prayer life. See, if we get this understanding between when you pray and your answer is manifest. There's an intense battle going on you don't see. Daniel 10 talks about it. We don't have time to go into it. Took Daniel 21 days. He had to stand fasting. But when the angel appeared, he said, from the first day you set your heart, I was dispatched from God. But lo, the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me. 21 days, amen. And Michael the archangel had to come and release him. In other words, between the asking and the receiving, there was an unseen battle going on. When we understand that as Christians, when I pray, if I don't see the answer instantly, it's not when I give up. That's why the Bible says that when you pray, amen, after you pray, you need to switch to thanksgiving. Amen. Because from the point you pray, the answer is on its way. It's unseen. You got to stand in faith unto the manifestation. Let everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. This is why, because unseen to me, the answer is on this way. But I've got to stand in faith. I've got to stand my ground. I can't back up. Stop talking ugly about it. I guess God didn't. He heard you. The Bible says his ear is attentive, open to our prayers. Amen. So he heard us. The answer is coming, but you got to stand. And it doesn't mean you're going to get it tomorrow, amen, or the day after. You've got to stand in faith. It might look worse while you're standing, but you got to stand. That's why he goes on to say, having done all, stand therefore. Put the armor on, but be prepared to stand. It's a spiritual battle. Don't give up. Some of us have things we're praying for, believing God for. We hadn't seen a manifestation of it. Don't quit. Don't give up. Amen? Amen. Stay in faith. Amen. Keep thanking God that you have received it. Amen. Amen. Whatsoever things you ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. Well, I don't see it right now. You got to stand in faith. Amen. Amen. See, there's an unseen battle going on. Our job is to stand. Amen. Amen. I don't have to see it to know that God is working in my behalf. That's where faith comes in. Amen. And so we're going to stand in faith. Amen. We're going to believe that our loved ones are coming in to be saved. They might act worse when you pray for them. Amen. Well, I believe he's going to save me and my whole house. Amen. Amen. Keep standing in faith. Amen. Amen. Because it's spiritual. And the enemy is a blowhard. He'll bluff you and try and make it look worse when you start standing and praying the word of God. Amen. Stand in faith. Amen. Again, to put on the armor of God. We'll get more into that in the future, but we've got to clothe ourselves. Get dressed right. And purpose in your heart, you will not quit. In Jesus' name. Every head bowed just for a moment. Father God, we give you praise for your word today, God. We thank you. You're addressing us for today's battles, God. So that giving us an understanding that what we see is not what we stand against or face, God. People are not our issue. Government is not our issue. It's the spirits that operate unseen behind the scene. So, God, we ask you to give us wisdom that we might stand. Lord, give us understanding hearts that we might rightly clothe ourselves in Jesus' name. And, God, that we might learn to use the weapons of our warfare. And to be effective, God, in standing and resisting the enemy and his schemes and attacks in the name of Jesus. I pray, God, that you would give us a special revelation of understanding, Lord, from the very youngest of us unto the oldest, God. That we all walk in your authority and in your power, God, and in your will. And understand who we are in Christ, Lord, as new creations in you. Born of the Spirit of God. Filled and baptized in the Holy Ghost, God, given the power, God, to stand and having an all to stand in Jesus' name. God, we thank you, Lord, for growing us, maturing us, developing us, and keeping us by your grace and power. For it, God, we give you the praise. We give you the glory in the mighty name of Jesus. Help us, God, to be fully dressed for our daily battles, God, that we might stand and glorify you. In Jesus' name, we thank you. Wherever head is bowed, if there's anyone here, and you say, Lord God, I need to settle my issue, my salvation. Am I saved? If you're not sure and you want to raise your hand, we'll pray with you. Amen. If you stumble back and you say, Lord, I want to come back home, we want to pray with you. Just lift your hand. Amen. In the name of Jesus.